quieten our hearts, Lord, from the cares of this world so that we may hear you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Welcome, Amen. Pastor Munala.
Thank you. Thank you, You're Pastor welcome. Mwangi. Hata nami na shukuru na nawasalimu nyote. Mesalimika Jay. Pastor Mwangi, thank you so much for leading us, and thank you for leading our marriage ministry. It's always wonderful to just see what God is doing in and through your life. I almost said Mam Jambo Tena. Let me just say greetings to you, Mamlaka Hill Chapel. How are you? It's wonderful to see you, and it's just a great time for all of us as we turn our attention to see what God has for us in his wonderful word. As Pastor Mwangi said earlier, we are beginning a new series on family and marriage. Of course, sometimes it's always difficult when you say we are doing a family series and then we spend a considerable amount of time talking about marriage. But I want you to know that there are many things that we have in store in the next coming weeks that we're going to be talking about that relate to family and marriage as a whole, and even parenting. I am very excited about this series because I believe that the family is the foundation upon which the church is built. The church is the instrument of God in bringing people back to himself. You know, God has a mission in this world, and his mission is to draw all men and women back to himself who are separated from him in the Garden of Eden when sin came about. And God uses the family to build up the church. And so for us, it is important that we focus on family and ensure that the strength of the families that are represented in our congregation are strong. I was recently asked a question as to what my opinion is in regards to the number one hindrance to growth in the Church of Jesus Christ in our time. I believe that the greatest hindrance to the growth in the body of Christ, the church, is not lack of leadership, nor is it instability as far as finances are concerned. Those and many other reasons indeed do contribute to the lack of growth that is needed in the body of Christ. But I want to say, in my opinion, the greatest hindrance to the growth in the body of Christ is what I call the disintegration of the family. Unstable marriages and unstable families account much to the lack of growth in many churches. Many churches have been constituted, put together for a purpose, which indeed is to propagate the gospel of Christ to the ends of the earth. But many churches are finding themselves not able to do that effectively because of the challenges that the families represented in those churches are having, the struggles that they are having, and the kind of preparation that the singles who are not married are being given as they enter into marriage. And so we are ending up with weak marriages, weak families that are therefore not able to contribute towards the growth and fulfillment of the mission that the church has given that God has given to the church. Just think with me for a moment in this place of a couple that is committed to the mission of Mamlaka Hill Chapel. Think with me about this couple. They fall in what we call hard times as far as their relationship is concerned. As a couple, this is a couple that contributes time and contributes money and is involved in various activities within this church. And their challenges reach a point where they cannot even resolve their conflict. I believe you will agree with me that chances for that couple, that family, to continue being engaged in the activities that help the church to realize its mission will be hindered, if not destroyed. You see, when the Bible talks about the devil and describes him as a thief, as a killer, and as a destroyer, I can't think of an area that the devil has done so much damage within the body of Christ as in this area of marriage and family. And that's why, as pastors here at Mamlaka Hill Chapel, we feel very strongly led to come back to you from time to time and say, watch out, take heed. Your enemy, the devil, plows around seeking for ways to destroy your marriage, to destroy your family, and to cause you to become unproductive as far as advancing the kingdom of God is concerned. And if you are a single man or a single woman, for him to distract you and to destroy your family even before it begins, that is Satan's agenda for the local church. In the years past, there were persecutions that Satan used to try and kill the church and cause the church not to advance. Now he has changed his tactics and he's focusing on the family. He's focusing on that single young man, that single young woman, as they prepare to come into marriage and making every effort to make sure that they start on the wrong footing so that they enter into marriage weakened. And for us, we feel that it's critical as pastors to come and to draw our attention again back to this very important subject so that we are well prepared and able to stand firm, because we know that we have a mission as a local body of Christ. Now, as we begin this series, I want to say that those of you who are sitting in here today and your marriage, your family has hit what we call a hard place and you're struggling. There are issues that are causing you to struggle as a couple and as a family. You are perhaps even reached a point where you have separated or even considering divorce or maybe even divorced. I want you to know that this series is not just for you. I don't want you to sit down there with guilt and shame as we go through this series. I also want you to know that there is no marriage or family represented in this church, in this building today, which does not need some kind of fixing in one way or another. There is no perfect family. There's no perfect marriage here. I, for one, my marriage is not perfect. My family is not perfect. There are areas that need to be fixed. And I can tell you, I am looking forward to this series so that I can learn new ideas. I can gain new ideas on how I can become a better man, how I can become a better father, and more than anything, how I can become a better husband. You see, our goal and our purpose during this time when we go through this series is to draw your attention, all of us, each one of us, to draw our attention to the cross of Jesus Christ, where we believe that there is healing, there is forgiveness, and there is restoration. We want to lift Jesus Christ up so high. Jesus, who is the foundation upon which the church is built. To raise him so high as we speak about these things that we'll be talking about, so that each one of us can see that there is hope. There is hope in Christ. That even though we may have struggles or we may have done bad things, we may have started the journey wrong as far as our families are concerned, that there is a Savior who wants to heal, to forgive, and to restore. and to give us the right foundation upon which to go. So I hope that during this period of time that you get drawn to Christ, and that as we finish this series, that your marriage will not just be better, but your relationship with our Lord Jesus Christ will be even far better than it is today. I want to begin our series by talking about God's design for marriage and family. In other words, what did God have in mind when he put this together, this thing we call marriage? Did he have a goal, a purpose to this? My conviction is that if your marriage, the current one and the future one, for those of you who are planning to get married, if it's going to thrive, if your family is going to thrive, it's going to be because you understand what God had in mind when he came up with this idea of marriage. And I want to thank the Lord because he has given us his word. And in his word, there is everything that we need that can help us to do well. God did not just toss marriage to us and throw it to us and said, you figure it out yourselves. In his goodness, he has everything that we need in his word. And so in the next several weeks, we are going to be looking through God's word to see, God, what do you have for us? Because we want to have good marriages. We want to have good families. We want to do well. What do you have for us in your word? I want us to start where it all starts in the book of Genesis by looking at God's design for marriage. Genesis chapter 2. In Genesis chapter 1, we are introduced to God and his handiwork of creation. God does a masterful piece of work. He sits back and he himself is proud of what he has done. He says, everything looked good. In chapter 2, he creates man. And then shortly thereafter, he also creates a woman. And he brings this man and this woman. The man's name is Adam. The woman's name is Eve. He brings them together. And he officiates at their wedding. During their wedding, God speaks to them a sermon, a message that they are to remember for the rest of their lives. And not only just for the rest of their lives, they are to pass on this message to their children and to their children's children and children's children. And in this message, this is what God says. It's contained in chapter 2 of Genesis, beginning from verse 24 to verse 25. It's a very brief sermon, but it is very, very loaded. This is what God tells Adam and Eve on their wedding day. He says, for this reason, a man shall leave his father and his mother and shall cleave to his wife, and they shall become one flesh. And then in verse 25, it says, Adam and his wife Eve were both naked, and they felt no shame. Now, in this passage, in this message, God, in speaking to Adam and Eve, reveals to us his mind regarding a marriage and what it is that constitutes a successful marriage and family. In this passage, I see three principles that God brings out that he desires for Adam and Eve to know, and in extension, all of us to know. This I call timeless principles. These are principles that were applicable to Adam and Eve as much as they were applicable to Isaac and Rebecca. These are principles that were applicable to Priscilla and Aquila in the New Testament as much as they are applicable to us today, and they will be applicable 100 years from now if Christ will not have returned by then. In other words, as long as there has been marriage, when these principles are applied, the result has always been a successful marriage and family. The first principle that God points out in this passage of Scripture is a principle I call the principle of living. He says in verse 24, "For this reason, a man leaves his father and mother." In other words, when a marriage takes place, as per God's design, there needs to be what I call a surgical disconnection between a marrying child and his or her parents. Now let me see if I can clarify what that means. The idea of leaving does not necessarily mean that when we get married, we are to have nothing whatsoever to do with our parents. It does not mean that our parents are no longer to be part of our lives in one way or another. It does not mean that we cannot consult, that we cannot care for, provide, and protect our parents. Contrary to that, the Bible clearly tells us that it is in when we honor our parents that God reaches out and blesses us. In fact, he says that he blesses us with longer life. So what does it really mean when it says that a man and a woman will leave father and mother? The word leave is the same word that is used in the book of Ephesians. Because this very same passage of Scripture is also used by Paul in Ephesians chapter 5. And in Ephesians, the word leave simply means departing or separation. In other words, when a woman get to the point of getting married, there needs to be a moving, there needs to be a separation that takes place between the marrying child and the parents. Perhaps the best illustration that helps us, that can help us to understand this, is an illustration that is used in many weddings that we call the lighting of the candle. Perhaps some of you used it in your wedding. What happens is that at the altar where a couple is going to get married, there is usually three candles, two on each side of two on the side of the one that is in the middle. Long before the marriage or the vows are exchanged, the parents of this couple that is about to get married will walk into the sanctuary and to the altar, and what they will do is that they will light the candles that are on the side of the one in the middle. And then they will walk out. During the ceremony itself, as this couple exchanges their vows, what will happen is that they will take, at a certain point, these two candles that were lit by their parents, and then they will light the one in the middle, and they will turn off the two that were lit by their parents, signifying that the lives that they were living with their parents, as it was known, has come to an end. They are beginning a total new life together as a new family. In other words, they are moving from this family, they are ending their relationship as, in that sense, from this family and beginning their own new family. You know, in a family structure, there are two kinds of families. There is what we call the child-parent relationship, and then there is what we call
the husband-wife relationship. Before marriage, the child-parent relationship is the most important, is a primary relationship. But after marriage, that needs to change. Because in God's design for marriage and family, the husband-wife relationship was designed to be the primary relationship because it is designed to be a permanent relationship. The child-parent relationship is not permanent, it's temporary. There's going to come a time of leaving. You know, one of these days, your son or your daughter will come into your living room as you read your newspaper, and they are going to inform you that they're leaving. Not leaving to go to college, but simply what they are going to be saying, that they have found someone that they intend to begin a new home with, meaning that they are going to leave. That is what God is telling Adam and Eve on their wedding day. He's saying to Adam and Eve, for this reason, a man leaves his father and mother. There has to be a disconnection that takes place. You see, problems occur in a marriage or in a family situation when the roles are reversed. When the child-parent relationship continues to be the primary relationship even after marriage. There are many parents who do not disconnect, who do not cut off that umbilical cord that ties them to their children, so that even after marriage, they still want to walk into their children's home to control the home, to determine how finances are used, to determine how children are raised. And the voice of the parents is so loud in the home that it makes it difficult for this new couple to thrive. Not long ago, I was bored. And when you're bored, you do some crazy things that you don't get to do. So I decided to watch a Nigerian movie. Some of these Nigerian movies are really cool. The movie that I ended up watching was about a wedding. And this couple got married. And then they went on honeymoon. A week and a half later, they returned home. When they returned home, they found mama of the boy at home. She had brought fufu and njugu and all kinds of stuff. Her intention was to teach this wife to her son how to cook for her son. In other words, she was so concerned that this woman was not going to treat her son well. And so she packed herself in this home for several months. As you can tell, you may not have watched the movie, but you know how the movie ended, that this relationship, this new relationship that had been built between this man and this woman did not do well because there was a parent who did not disconnect and felt that they must ensure that things run well. Some couples have what I call an imaged relationship with their parents, so much so that even after marriage, they are still dependent on their parents to provide for them. They are dependent on them emotionally. When they have a need, the first place they run to is to mama and papa. You know, when you become totally dependent on your parents for sustenance, it begs the question, why are you really prepared for marriage? Pastor Mwangi, when he does his pre-marriage classes, he emphasizes the fact to our singles. You need to be prepared financially. Because let me tell you something that you may not know. It is not cheap
to be married. It costs. And as such, you need to have money. You cannot just look at your father's wealth and say, I can get married because my dad has resources. It will not work well for your marriage. You must be prepared. I'm not talking about being wealthy. I'm talking about being able to sustain your marriage. If I was a lady, I would not get married to a man who cannot be able to afford a wedding, a marriage. Now, remember, I'm not talking about wealth. I'm talking about the ability to be able to pay rent and to buy food. This is very important for you couples who are dating and or for you singles who are looking forward to getting married. That it is important for you to be prepared and to know that I need not to be dependent on those that have raised me when it comes to the whole issue of marriage. I've sat down with many couples to find out that because the parents have been allowed to finance, they come also with a voice. Because we gave you the money, we want to know how you are using it. And that can be a bit hard. God not only gives Adam and Eve the principle of living, but he also gives them another principle that is critical. So he's not just saying a man shall leave his father and mother, but he tells us what next happened, what happens next. He says, and shall cleave to his wife. In verse 24, it says, for this reason, a man leaves his mother and father and cleaves to his wife. Now, the word cleave is an important word here. It's the same word that is used in the book of Psalms and also in the book of Job. Job used this word to describe his tongue when it got stuck on the roof of his mouth. In other words, Job was going through a very difficult time. And he became so sick that his mouth became so, so dry that when he would lift up his tongue, it would get stuck on the roof of his mouth. The idea here that this word conveys, it conveys the idea of sticking together in affection and loyalty. The idea of permanence is the one that God had in mind when he tells Adam and Eve that you will cleave to each other. In other words, in God's plan for marriage, when God put together this institution called marriage, his intent was that the two that come to be married at the altar or before a judge or in a traditional way would live together permanently. You know, when we attend a wedding and we look at a couple as they exchange vows, we don't usually sit there saying, I know that they will only last 4 or 3 years. I hope that that's not the case. I hope that we are all, when we are at the wedding, we are constantly cheering on this couple as they get married, that they will live together until what? Until death parts them. None of us ever goes into a marriage relationship, stands at the altar or goes to a judge or wherever you get married, with an intent to walk away from that marriage or to see that marriage come and break down. I believe 99.9%, maybe there's just a 1% that would go into a marriage with other reasons. But for most part, we want our marriages to last until death do us part. But unfortunately, many couples come into marriage without really thinking about the process that is going to enable them to be together until death do us part. That's why as Adam and Eve are getting married, God wants to emphasize one very critical point to them. And that is Adam and Eve, this relationship that is starting today, is to be maintained until death parts you. Someone came up with these vows that we normally include in our vows that I think is very Genesis based. This vow that says, for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in health, as in sickness. These words are exactly what God is talking about when he tells Adam and Eve, cleave together. You see, the cleaving in Genesis means that today, as I stand at the altar with my partner to get married, I look at my husband-to-be and I'm seeing and knowing that they have resources, that they are wealthy, that they have done well in life. And so we are entering our marriage relationship on a good financial standing. And I'm making my commitment to him, but I also realize that we live in a very unstable, unpredictable world. And that it's possible that in the next 5 years, this man who is wealthy that I'm getting married to may lose his job, may become broke, his business may fall apart, and he may become broke. But today, I am making a commitment to cleave to him, for richer or for poor. If anything bad happens in our lives, I am not going to leave because apparently he is not wealthy as he was when we began our relationship of marriage. Cleaving that Genesis talks about means that today I am getting married to this wonderful, beautiful young lady. And it's a joy for me, and I'm so thankful that she looks fabulous. But it's very possible that in the next 10 years or 15 years or 20 years, health issues will come in and her beauty will disappear. Or she may have an accident and she will not be the same person that I am looking at today. But I am making a commitment to cleave to her in health, as in sickness. I once heard a girl say this, which I thought was very powerful. She said, cleaving for me means that as we are entering this marriage, we are entering it poor. We don't have a lot of resources. But in due course, I may rise and make a lot of money. More money than my husband will ever make. But today, I am committing to cleave for richer or for poorer. And then she said, I will not leave him or mistreat him just because I make more money than he does. That is what cleaving is all about. It has to do with us recognizing that in God's plan for marriage and for family, permanence was part of the equation. But God doesn't stop there. He gives us the third principle. And it has to do with one flesh. He says, for this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and will cleave to his wife. And then he says, the two who are separate will now become one flesh. Now, the term one flesh means that just as our bodies are one entity and cannot remain one entity if they are cut into pieces, so in marriage, when two individuals come at the altar to be married, they become one. They no longer are two. In God's vision, in God's understanding of marriage, these two become one. The problem with most marriages of our day is that couples come into a marriage relationship half-heartedly because they are not so sure that things will work out. And so you may hear someone say something like, I have an uncle who got married. Before he got married, he was very wealthy. But then his marriage went wrong. And there was a divorce. And since then, he is a poor man. Tell me, why would I go into a marriage relationship without taking precaution? I'm not so sure it's going to work. Or perhaps someone who said, I know of a friend who got married, and then there was a divorce by her husband, divorced her, and left her in a destitute situation with nothing. So the question is, why would I want to go into a marriage relationship without taking some precaution? And so some couples, many couples in our day today, enter into marriage by signing what we call a prenuptial, or making what we call a prenuptial nuptial agreement regarding the ownership of their property should this marriage go bad. Now, I don't know what your thinking is in regards to that, but I want to draw your attention to what I believe is God's opinion regarding that kind of an issue. And it's very clear from what God tells Adam and Eve on that very first day. And that is that when you two become married, you become one. Which simply means that everything about our lives becomes but one, or become begin to belong to all of us equally. I like the words of Peter Marshall and David Miguel, who've written a book entitled Light and Glory. In this book, concerning marriage, they said, marriage is a union, domestic and social, spiritual and physical. It is a fusion of two hearts, the union of two lives, which after being joined in marriage, follow the same direction, carrying the same burdens of responsibilities and obligations. And I want to add that in this kind of union, you'll not find things such as, she has her own money and I have my own money. She pays for this bill and I pay for that bill. She takes care of her parents and I take care of my parents. Many of the couples who I have sat with struggling in their relationship are couples who entered into a relationship, into a marriage relationship, and violated this principle. They did not spend time enough together to trust one another, entered into a marriage relationship, not trusting each other, and now they are operating, two governments in the same house, which really doesn't work and will not work. You see, my wife, who is not here today, doesn't make money in the sense of having a job that makes money. But you see, that doesn't matter, because the money that we make belongs to her. She can use the money that I bring home, any way that she sees fit for the maintenance and care of our home. When I was in school, I did not have a regular job. And she is the one who worked and brought all the money that we needed home. It did not matter. When that money hit our bank account, I used it the way that I wanted, as I saw fit for the well-being of our home and the care of our home. Why? Because there was a time, in fact, in this very, very building, almost 30-something years ago, my wife and I stood at the altar. It used to be inside there. And we said that we want to become one flesh. And when we said we want to become one flesh, what we meant is that everything about our lives, everything that we own, belong to each of us equally. Someone will say, Pastor, that is about 30 years ago. We are living in a total different dispensation. These are timeless principles. And even if we are living in a different dispensation today, I can attest, and I'm sure that the rest of the pastors who connect with struggling couples will say, one of the sources of conflict, major conflicts, is because there is no oneness in the home. It is important, especially for those of you who are not married and you're looking forward to getting married, it's important for you to look at the person that you want to get married to and ask yourself the very difficult question, which is, can I trust this individual that they are going to be one with me in every way? I know that many young people, when you fall in love, we normally put on these glasses that we call love is blind glasses. And there are a lot of things that we ignore. Or we have this idea that things change when we get into marriage. And I say, no, they don't change. You need to be able to say, this man is a godly man. And I know that he can take care of me. This woman is indeed a partner that I know I can walk with. A young man asked, how do you tell? And I say that there are many, many ways when you are dating. That's why I don't like to marry a couple who just met 3 months ago and they say, we are so much in love, can you marry us? I say, no, can you date for another 6 or 8 months before we even begin to consider? Because you need time to be able to know some things. For example, how do you know that that young man is going to be committed to you financially? You observe him when you go to restaurants. Does he struggle to... when the bill comes, does he become uncomfortable? Does he forget his wallet all the time? Observe him. Listen to him as he talks about how he cares for his family, his parents. Does he care for his sick parents? And for you guys, it's almost the same thing. If you take your girl out for dinner, you take her for lunch, 1 week, 2 weeks, 3 weeks, 4 weeks, and every time you are taking out your wallet and paying and paying and paying, and she never touches her purse, never even say something like, you've been paying, can I take care of this? Now, of course, if she said that, if you're a gentleman like me, you say, no, you cannot pay. But what you do is you treasure that in your heart. You put it in your heart and you say, this is a good woman. Because she's willing to share the burden with you and not just leave it to you. If you have such kind of a friend, my advice to you as a young man is drop her. Seriously. Because she's the one who is going to start making a lot of money and she's going to mistreat you. Because she's not ready to be part with you. If you are a girl and this guy will never part with his 5 shillings, drop him. Seriously, just let the guy go and find yourself a godly, caring man. And I may add this to you, young ladies. If you have this young man that you are dating, you want to go into marriage with, but every time you meet for a date, he's pressuring you into a sexual relationship. Every time he talks, you know where he wants to go with you. Drop that guy. Seriously. Why do I say this? It's because if this guy holds on to his wallet and will not share, he's going to hold on to his wallet for the rest of his life. And you are going to suffer in that marriage. If he pressures you today, he knows that there is something wrong about sex outside of marriage, and yet he has the courage of continuing to pressure you and pressure you into a sexual relationship with you. You know that when you get married, 15 years later, he's going to do the same thing with someone else, not you. Because this is his way of life. Now, I know you believe that things change in marriage, and they do. And that's why we're talking about focusing on the cross of Jesus Christ as the healing place for all of us. Because many of us started our marriages wrong. But before you get married, don't take the risk. That is oneness, flesh, one flesh, of one fleshness, if there's anything like that, that the Bible is talking about. Equally engaged in every way of your lives. But there is another area that God is referring to when he tells Adam and Eve that the two will become one flesh. So there is the becoming one flesh in terms of stuff and things and life and children. But there's also becoming one flesh which has to do with sexual intimacy. It is very interesting that after God finishes his sermon to Adam and Eve, when he says, "For this reason, a man will leave his father and mother and shall cleave to his wife, and the two will become one flesh," we are told in verse 25 that Adam and Eve were naked, and yet they were not ashamed of each other. Now, many of us, when we think about the Garden of Eden, we tend to see Adam and Eve walking naked. And we tend to think that that is how they were in the Garden of Eden. They did not need clothes in the Garden of Eden. Now, I beg to differ with that opinion. Now, this is my opinion. I'm not saying that this is scripturally correct, maybe scripturally correct, but I'm just saying that this is my opinion. My opinion is that Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden had clothes on. And in fact, when they stood before God on that day when he officiated at their wedding, they were well-dressed. But what happened is that immediately after their wedding, immediately after exchanging their vows, they did what many of us have done, which is they went to honeymoon. Probably they went to what would be called at the time Eden Lodge. And that's why verse 25 says, they were naked and they were not ashamed of each other. It's a diplomatic way of saying that they consummated their marriage. Because in God's design for marriage, sexual intimacy is very important. God did not leave this out because it was something that was crafted onto marriage and said, oh, by the way, I forgot to include this. You take this as well. It was part of what God designed there to be. And that's why he's talking about one fleshness in regard to this area. You see, a man and a woman who come together at the altar to be married, in the bonds of marriage, begin to live out the joys of a sexual relationship, and it is exactly as God designed it. God blesses it, and there is nothing, absolutely nothing, shameful about a sexual union between a husband and a wife. God designed it that way. Problems come when a man and a woman, married or single, come together and they engage in sexual activity outside the bonds of marriage. It's abnormal as far as God is concerned. God cannot understand why anyone would want to do that, because that was not his original design. His design was, here is a man, here is a woman, they are getting married. Now this is the gift that will help to cement their relationship and make it firm and strong. Sexuality within marriage is expected by God. See, when a couple gets married, and if they were to come back to me and tell me, oh, we did not, then I will say to them, I don't think you guys are married, because it is expected that this activity is part of a marriage relationship. And there is nothing shameful about it. I can see some of you pinching each other there. One of the areas that God has attacked, and many marriages that have been wounded today, have been wounded because this area has been mishandled, this area of sexual intimacy. And Satan knows very well that this is a dicey, so to speak, an area that needs to be handled well. And he will attack the area. And my challenge to all of us today is that we need to pay attention to what's going on in our world and how it is that Satan can grab this and cause there to be trouble in your home, thing that God created to strengthen your relationship and make it strong and make it what it was designed to be. For this reason, a man leaves his father and mother and cleaves. The two become one flesh. That's God's vision for a marriage. Now, I began by saying that we will draw your attention to the cross of Christ, because many of us started it wrong, or many of us are struggling, or many of us look at some of the things that we've talked about, and you can see that there is an issue here and there is an issue there. Let me draw your attention to Jesus Christ, who says, come unto me, all of you who labor, and I will give you rest. Don't leave this place feeling condemned and feeling that you did it wrong. Cry out to the Lord Jesus Christ. He is a healer and restorer. Let me ask Pastor Mwangi to come and pray for us.
Shall we rise up for prayer now? Lord Jesus, we have heard your word, and many of us, I can bet, we are processing this in our own ways. Yet, Father, we all choose now to look up to you, because truth be told, marriage was your idea, God. You are the author of marriages. We've had what model you would want all of us to follow. We have heard about your design for marriage. Father, for those of us who, truth be told, we chose to do our own things and not follow your counsel, have mercy on us and forgive us, Father. Hold our hands, Lord. Hold our hands. We hear you. Again, Lord, for those in very different situations in their marriages, and perhaps some of the truths that have come to us so clearly have touched us certain ways. Again, Lord, we look up to you. we look up to you. Father, where can we go? Where can we go other than to look up to you, Jesus Christ, and what you did when you hung on that cross? So, Father, for all of us, I pray that you will give us the boldness to approach you. We confess together that you are the only true solution to the many problems in our relationships and our marriages and our families. Father, hear us. And now to all of you, brothers and sisters, may the Lord bless and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Go in peace and have a fantastic week.
We were made to be courageous. We were made to lead the way. We can be